Welcome to Taylor Treasures!
Hello and welcome back to the show!
Welcome back!
Welcome back! So today is another edition of old vintage TV shows that we like to talk about.
Mm-hmm.
And this one today is about the Dick Van Dyke Show. Now this one is very special to me. This happens to be my favorite of all the vintage TV shows.
Yay!
I love it. It's so funny. It's so good quality. And I've watched it for years. And so I wanted to share today, this is going to be a two-part episode.
Today's, oh boy, you're only getting part one today.
Right. There is so much information that I could only fit a certain amount in today. So what we're going to do today is we're going to show just an overview of the show, still some really interesting details, and pretty much how the show came to be. And then there'll be another episode later that's more about fun facts about the show that you didn't know, that are more just like a list, but this is more of like the story of how it became what it was.
So story time.
Right. So
would you say this is your favorite black and white old-fashioned TV show?
It is.
Okay.
It is. I do like I Love Lucy a lot, but this one tops it. It does. I love it. Okay, so the Dick Van Dyke Show had 5 seasons, and it ran from 1961 to 1966, and it was produced and created by Carl Reiner. And the show starred Dick Van Dyke, Mary Tyler Moore, Rosemary, Maury Amsterdam, Richard Deacon, and Morgan Gilbert, Jerry Paris, Carl Reiner, and Larry Matthews. So this is how it sort of began. So in the summer of 1958, while vacationing with his family in Fire Island, New York, Carl Reiner was inspired by his wife Estelle to write his own script of a TV show, and he named it Head of the Family. It was strongly based on his and his family's life. Because it was so real to his life experiences, the stories just kept on coming, and within the few weeks that they were there at Fire Island, he wrote 13 full scripts of TV show.
That's a lot of writing.
Yeah, it's a lot of writing.
How long did it say? He was there for 3 weeks?
I think around like three weeks around.
Because I just was listening to a podcast the other day, and they said that 2 people for 1 script spent 3 weeks writing that for the show The Office. They usually did 1 week, but it was a really good episode, and they spent 3 weeks on 1 script. So that's a lot of scripts.
That is a lot of scripts. Yeah, a lot of scripts. So he was really inspired. And at the time, he, his wife, and his kids lived in New Rochelle, New York, and that is why the Petries also live there. It's interesting to see how much of the show was really true to Reiner's life, as you will see. So the main character, which at the time was named Robbie Petrie, not Rob Petrie.
Like a Petri dish.
Yeah. That character was the well-known TV writer Reiner had always aspired to be. Laura Petrie, at the time, was of course Carl Reiner's real wife. Richie Petrie was Carl Reiner's son, Robert. And Buddy Sorrell was based on Mel Brooks, who was a friend and fellow actor of Reiner's.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Mel Brooks.
Right. I can kind of see it.
I can see it now.
Yeah. And Sally Rogers was a combination of the Your Show of Shows writer Lucille Callan and Caesar's Hour writer and sometimes actress on the show, Selma Diamond. And Reiner had actually previously acted on both of those shows with those women, so they were sort of friends of his.
He's like, we gotta put him in there.
Right. And lastly, Jerry and Millie Helper were based on the Reiner's real-life New Rochelle neighbors called Jerry and Millie Schoenbaum. I believe that's how you pronounce it.
Actually Jerry and Millie.
It was Jerry and Millie. Yeah.
I don't know if I'd be too flattered if I'm portraying those two.
Yeah. Which is actually interesting because those neighbors, similar to the show, moved from the Bronx to New Rochelle with the Reiners at the same time to that neighborhood. And it's very like the show. If you remember the episode, Your Home Sweet Home is My Home, the Petries and the Helpers move to New Rochelle from another neighborhood together. So that was kind of based on that. But one difference is that Jerry Helper's strong personality was based much more on the actor who portrayed him, which was Jerry Paris, rather than the real Jerry that he knew. And as you might expect, many of the episodes of the show were exaggerated reality rather than fiction. Reiner said that some of his favorite episodes were the Army flashbacks, and like Rob, he was actually stationed in Camp Crowder, Missouri in World War II. A difference from the show was that, unlike the character Laura, Estelle wasn't a USO girl, but she would often come and visit Reiner at Camp Crowder. And the episode, Honeymoons Are for the Lucky, was partially true. So Reiner didn't do what Rob did, which was dress up like a woman to get away from the base for his honeymoon. But he did actually try to leave the base, Reiner, and he was caught. And when his officer in charge wouldn't listen to him about his honeymoon with his wife Estelle, he snuck off the base again, climbing a fence to be with Estelle. So
oh boy.
He did actually get
in more trouble than that.
Yeah. He didn't really ever say what happened after he got back, but I guess they let him go.
He was like, well, we need men, so.
Yeah, right. So according to Reiner, the episode Never Name a Duck, which that was one of the first episodes I ever saw the Dick Van Dyke Show, because I loved the show as a kid, but I only had seen like 5 episodes because we had one DVD that had the Dick Van Dyke Show.
Yes, and that was the first one that played, was Never Name a Duck.
Yeah, it was
so
that
we
one.
We watched that one a billion times.
Right, and then it was the one about Buddy's brother, and then the bank book, Laura's bank book, and there were like 2 others. And it wasn't until a few years after that I got to see every season, but.
There's more shows than that.
Right. But that episode, the Never Name a Duck, was actually very similar to the real-life story. Like Rob, Reiner did actually bring home baby ducklings to his son Lucas. And like the episode, they actually did live in a sink for a while and ate Rice Krispies. But just like the episode, in the end, they did have to give away the full-grown ducks. It was very short-lived. They actually got to get rid of these because they poop a lot.
What are you going to do with ducks?
Yeah, right.
Unless they have diapers.
Right. And the last episode I wanted to bring up is, though the episode The Unwelcome House Guest was completely fiction and it was about the Petries watching Buddy's big German Shepherd, it was actually one of the original 13 scripts that he wrote at Fire Island, and he got the inspiration for the episode when he looked down at his big German Shepherd while he was writing. Let's write about the dog.
Why not?
And he actually always said that while he was there writing those scripts, if he ever ran out of ideas, he pretty much would just look around his room and see what was in there, and it would give him an idea for another script.
We do that with the news.
We do. What do we have in here? How about a pot?
There's a broom.
Yeah, all the time.
Okay, so with 13 scripts fully ready, Reiner was completely invested in his project, and by December of 1958, the pilot for Head of the Family was being filmed. The pilot would not have a live audience, and it would be filmed with one camera instead of the usual 3. It would be filmed over a few days, which was also not normal. Reiner had decided that he himself would play Robbie Petrie, and the other cast would be Barbara Britton, was going to be Laura, Gary Morgan was going to be Richie, Morty Gundy was going to be Buddy, and Sylvia Miles was going to be Sally. So 13 scripts of work, he had months of planning, he was really hoping it would be the big break that he had always wanted. Unfortunately, it was not meant to be yet.
Mm-hmm.
The pilot was a true disaster. It was bland and humorless, and the networks chose not to pick up the show, and we did watch it. It is pretty terrible.
It's pretty terrible.
It's not funny at all.
No.
It's like, what is this even about?
Right.
So, at the time, anyway, CBS was more looking for westerns, detective shows, and adventures. They really were not into the situation comedies thing at the time.
Mm-hmm.
Even though the scripts, they were very well written, they were professional, and they were full of lots of comedic potential, the casting choice and the overall directing of the pilot was just not in a good place. And so, a disappointed Reiner threw his 13 scripts of hard work into a basket.
So, there were a few people who helped Reiner's show get a second chance, but no one was a bigger help than actor and producer Sheldon Leonard. If you've seen It's a Wonderful Life, then you might be familiar with him as Nick the Bartender, or if you've seen any tough guy or criminal in a 1930s to 1960s film, it was probably Leonard. Yeah, very, very big tough guy. He also ended up making a cameo in the Dick Van Dyke Show as Big Max Calvada.
Which was, again, like a thug gangster.
Yeah, he was like a mobster kind of guy. Yeah. And Leonard was the one person in power that actually saw great potential in Reiner's show, though many changes would need to be made. At the time, Leonard had already been producing shows like The Andy Griffith Show and The Danny Thomas Show, and he asked Reiner if he was willing to give his show another go, and Reiner was more than happy to say yes. The biggest changes for the show that Leonard wanted was using a live audience, 3 cameras, and getting a whole new cast. But the biggest blow was that he had to tell Reiner that he would not be able to play Robbie Petrie. So he did end up telling him, but Reiner actually took it surprisingly well. And the last 2 changes was that Leonard would be the executive producer and Reiner would be the producer.
So finding the new cast was the biggest priority, as was finding, obviously, Rob Petrie, who was previously Robbie Petrie, and they did end up changing the name. So the last name ended up being Petrie. And that wasn't until a little bit later, but we're just going to call him Petrie. Country, since that's right. his name. So, moving on.
And that's also, I'll say in part two, but I just want to briefly say that the Petri pronunciation is actually a big ongoing joke in the show. And it's funny because it's actually in real life that it yes. was changed.
Yeah, it's easy to get them backwards.
Right.
So Leonard had known about Dick Van Dyke from seeing him actually on Broadway. While he was looking for the right Rob, Leonard again saw Van Dyke on Broadway. At the time, he was playing Albert Peterson in Bye Bye Birdie. After seeing his performance, Leonard just knew he found Rob, and he soon got in contact with him. But Dick Van Dyke, he accepted the role. He was very excited, but he was still under contract with Broadway. So because of this, for the first full season of the new TV show, he would go between filming and rehearsing in California and then performing on Broadway in New York
wow.
in Bye Bye Birdie.
Oh my gosh, that would be so,
so
much
he was
work.
A very busy man.
yeah.
For a while. That was only until he could end his contract with Broadway in New York.
Right. So that was only for one season.
Right. Yeah. So the another interesting thing is that Van Dyke is the only cast member who got any money from reruns of the show. And he probably still gets a paycheck today.
Mm-hmm.
Which is interesting. So with finding Sally Rogers, it was really easy for Reiner and Leonard because from the start, they only saw one person to play her, and that was none other than Rose Marie.
Mm-hmm.
She accepted the role very happily. Soon after that, Marie actually suggested someone for the role of Buddy Sorrell, Maury Amsterdam. She had known him actually since she was 11 and was even his daughter Kathy's godmother, mm-hmm. which is interesting.
Yeah.
They had him audition for the role, and although to Reiner, he had envisioned the character to be a young 24-year-old. He quickly saw the 52-year-old was perfect for the role, and actually, I can't imagine it with a younger guy.
No.
Because that, I feel like that would have been, like,
it would
Rob
be a weird
and
dynamic.
The other guy would kind of have to be neck and neck, because you feel like, you know, Buddy's older, and he's kind of, he's happy where he is, but
right.
if the guy was younger, I don't know, I think it was better with an older
Yeah, it's kind of a different dynamic. Yeah, it would be, like, maybe more competition than
yeah.
it was on the actual show.
So finding the right Laura Petri was the most difficult, and Reiner had looked at about 60 women before he found Mary Tyler Moore. Oh my
at
goodness.
At that point, they would just all mush together.
You'd be like, I don't know. They have hair.
yeah.
So one day, he and Leonard were talking with the associate executive producer of the show, Danny Thomas, about finding the right Laura, and he said there was one girl he remembers auditioning for the daughter of his show, which would have been the Danny Thomas show. She was very close to getting the role, but ended up not being quite right for the part. Thomas said, I don't remember who she was, except that she had three names.
Yeah, that's a lot of help.
Thanks. Nonetheless, they did end up finding her and asked her to come and audition. At the time, Moore was extremely low on work and almost didn't go to the audition because she'd already had three or four bad auditions that week. But thankfully, she did end up going, and even though Moore, she always thought she performed horribly for that audition, Reiner gave her the role almost immediately. He just took her into Leonard's office and said excitedly, this is the girl. She said hello like a real person. I don't know what that means.
It just
I guess
means
she was believable.
The right person. yeah, I guess finding like a believable person to play like
yes,
a wife
you don't want
in
it to be
show.
Too fake.
Right.
Yeah. There are, of course, other cast members, but we have limited time, so we decided to share just the main highlights of the cast, and the other cast members got their parts in a more mundane way, though that doesn't make it any less important.
So, as executive producer of the show, Sheldon Leonard oversaw the legal and financial aspects of the show, though he did actually direct the pilot and a few other episodes, like one or two. And Leonard was also known as a very good budgeter, and when it was all said and done, the second try at Reiner's pilot cost between $40,000 and $47,000, and even for then, that was very, very modest for a pilot. That doesn't even compare to today's pilots that cost between $350,000 to $2 million to film.
Wow.
That's a lot.
That's crazy.
I did not realize for one episode it can cost that much. But
me neither.
Yeah. In part two, we will also go over a little bit more on how he was able to keep the show so cheap. It was just through all the seasons he did little things here and there that kept it really at a low price.
Right.
While planning the pilot, other changes were made to the show besides the cast, and the original title of the show, Head of the Family, just wasn't working for Leonard and Reiner, so they started to throw around different titles, and a couple of them were The Full House, which kind of interesting that there's a show called Full House, Double Trouble, and All in a Day's Work. But finally, Reiner was inspired by the Andy Griffith Show, naming it after the main actor of the same name, and he chose The Dick Van Dyke Show. Now, Dick Van Dyke wasn't sure that this was a good idea, because at the time, nobody really knew who he was, unless you were a big Broadway person.
Yeah, and be like, hey, random person, this is named after you.
Yeah, it'd be like my show,
well,
the Lucia Taylor
why
Show.
Why would I watch that?
Who?
I don't know who that is.
Yeah. But Reiner was very confident in what he had chosen. As filming of the pilot approached, Dick Van Dyke said that he was incredibly nervous, so nervous that he got 4 cold sores, one that was so big that it was right by his mouth, might even been on his lip a little bit. It was so big that they'd put a bunch of makeup on it to cover it. And if you notice in that episode, he looks kind of odd around his mouth. That's because it was caked on there.
Whoops.
Yeah. And so on January 19th, 1961, a crowd of people lined up outside the Desilu Studios to be the first live audience of the new show. That would be so iconic. Go to that pilot.
If you could go back there. In time, that's where you would go.
Oh, probably. For sure. Definitely. It goes without saying that the pilot was a huge success, and it was picked up by CBS right away. Reiner, Leonard, and the whole cast were overjoyed, and soon, millions of American viewers would be too. But not as soon as Reiner and Leonard would have hoped.
Nope, that is the case. Mm-hmm. The relief of the show being picked up did not last forever. And the end of the show's first season, it was looking as though the show was going to be canceled.
I know.
Almost all season, the show had been 8th place at the 16.1 rating, meaning only 16.1 households were watching the show, next to the top show, which is a 32.1 rating. Though the reason for the bad rating was really never fully known, it was no fault of the show itself. At the time, the two producers thought maybe it was a bad time slot. The show's first season was played on Tuesday nights at 8, which was too early for most adults to watch. Mm-hmm. Eventually, Reiner and Leonard were able to change the show's time slot to Wednesday nights at 9:30 by mid-first season, but unfortunately that had little to affect the show's actual ratings. By the end of the season, the show's sponsor, Procter & Gamble, was not willing to support another year and seemed all hope was lost in making another season.
Mm-hmm. Who's gonna sponsor it?
I know, no one. Right? But Leonard was not giving up just yet. Leonard traveled from LA to Cincinnati, Ohio, where Procter & Gamble's headquarters was, and still is, stationed, and personally pitched the show's next season to them and asked them to continue to sponsor the Dick Van Dyke Show. Somehow, he talked them into continuing to sponsor them, but as soon as he got back to LA, Procter & Gamble called him to say they changed their minds.
Procter &
Gamble.
And
they were only willing to continue to sponsor half of the show.
Oh boy. And so he got back and he's like,
I know, he's like, exhausted. I'm sure he was like, you know, he went on this whole rampage, I'm gonna do it, I'm gonna save the show, and then he got it, and then he got back and they're like,
never mind.
Yeah. Well, he was very tired, but Leonard decided to travel to the tobacco company, for some reason, Lori Lard, and thankfully he was able to get them to sponsor the other half of the show's next season. Mm-hmm. So you know what? He figured it out.
He did. So with 2 sponsors for the show, the cast and crew started on a second season of the show. Still unsure as to how well the next season would do. As it would happen, summer reruns and a new hit TV show would allow the Dick Van Dyke Show to become a huge success for the next 4 years. So during the summer of 1962, the first season of the Dick Van Dyke Show was discovered by millions of Americans watching summer reruns of the show. And of course, they soon fell in love with the show. Also, during the summer, there was much less competition for the Dick Van Dyke Show because a lot of the shows just weren't on or they were reruns. And so people would be willing to give it more of a shot of watching it instead of going to their other shows. And by the fall of 1962, people were eagerly awaiting a second season of the Dick Van Dyke Show. Another major boost for the Dick Van Dyke Show was a new TV show called The Beverly Hillbillies. This new show was instantly a major success and soon gained the top rating, and they would keep it for most of the years that it was on. But how did this help the Dick Van Dyke Show, you may ask? Well, the Dick Van Dyke Show was placed right after the Beverly Hillbillies in the Wednesday night lineup. So this means that the many people that came for the Beverly Hillbillies stayed for the Dick Van Dyke Show. And unlike the show's first season's 16.1 rating, the Dick Van Dyke Show's rating leaped to a whopping 24.8 audience rating.
That's pretty great.
And this would allow the show to go on for a full 5 seasons.
So the Dick Van Dyke Show was one of the top shows of the 1960s and was loved by Americans all over the country. So you may ask, why only 5 seasons?
Not that long.
Well, that was Carl Reiner's decision. Since around season 3, he had decided that 5 seasons would be plenty. And it was actually an incredibly wise decision. He wanted the show to end on a high note instead of doing too many seasons and watching it go downhill. Even with several writers, making an original and funny script every week for 5 years is a tough thing to do. Mm-hmm. And Carl knew that sooner or later, the show would become bland and repetitive. And so, on June 1st, 1966, the last show of the Dick Van Dyke Show, called The Last Chapter, aired on CBS and in American homes.
So that was the last you would see of the Dick Van Dyke Show.
Yes.
Yes.
Had a great run.
It did. And you know what? Maybe, I mean, it's sad that it didn't go on longer, but I guess it might have not been as good as it had gone on. And I think
well, you watch other shows, like, you know, the Andy Griffith Show went for a long time.
Right, and after
and
Barney
people
left
yeah. and it just wasn't funny anymore.
Right, and honestly, I'm still surprised that it went on for as long as it did when, you know, Barney left, because he was a big part of the show, and then it was just Andy had yes. to be the funny guy. But yeah, that was what we wanted to share today of the Dick Van Dyke Show. Again, we're going to make a part two of this about more of the fun details that you might have not known about the show and its making. But this is just how it came to be. And before we go on to the news, I wanted to say two more things. And one, briefly, is that I think it's really cool that WandaVision came out recently and that they kind of brought to light the Dick Van Dyke Show more than it had been for years. And now, like, other young people are finding it. I see, like, the views are going up on the Dick Van Dyke Show and stuff because people see it there. And it's funny because...
It was cool to watch it because we're like...
I know.
We've seen that. That's the Dick Van Dyke Show.
It's like they played in one of the episodes. I won't give anything away, but there's one episode that's played of the Dick Van Dyke Show and someone in the Marvel cast is watching it. And I'm like, I know that episode and it's in Marvel.
We've sat and watched it.
It's so weird that it was, of all places, the Dick Van Dyke Show on Marvel is just two very different things. But yes. I thought that was neat.
Yes. And also, I've always obviously liked the show because they have a great name for the wife character. Her name is Laura.
Oh, I know. Isn't that great?
And interestingly enough, I have found somebody who I'm going to marry named Robert.
Isn't yes.
Or Rob.
Right.
So we are Rob and Laura, which
I know.
Is kind of funny.
That's
so
cool.
We have our kid. Maybe I have to name him Richard. But it's funny because our aunt, that's how she always remembers his name. She's like, you're Rob and Laura.
I know. It is very interesting. That's all I think about when I, Rob and Laura. And so the last thing I wanted to show, I've showed this before on other shows, but maybe you haven't seen every episode, so I wanted to bring it out again. If you know the show, you know that I am a big collector of autographs. Some of them I've gotten from the people, you know, meeting them, but a lot of them I've gotten through the mail by sending in a blank picture, and then they send it back autographed. It's a really cool thing that you can do. And if you want to see the episode on how to do that, we made one up here a while ago. And I actually have two autographs from people from the Dick Van Dyke Show. So the first one is, and this was one of... It might have been the first autograph I ever got when I started collecting. So
this is the beginning.
Yeah. And I was about 12, and I got Rosemary's autograph.
Look at that.
Look at that.
Now, if you didn't watch the show, there is a story with this one.
Oh, yeah.
The story is that she sent it off. We don't know how it got back here because when the return envelope came, it didn't really have the right stuff on it. The zip code was wrong.
What else was wrong? I think it was just the zip code was wrong. It was like one...
But I don't even think it had your right name on it.
I don't know. It was like one number off, I think.
I think even our house address was wrong. There was something off about two parts of it. I remember that.
Yeah.
But somehow
it got here.
And I don't know how the post office figured
it out.
I don't know.
But yeah, so I have Rosemary's. Thought that was neat. And I actually got it like a year or two before she died, I think.
Yeah,
so
it was right before she passed.
Right. And then the other one I have is, there's other autographs
none
on
other
here,
than
Dick Van Dyke! I got Dick Van Dyke's.
How cool is that?
I know, I got that, it was like probably two years ago.
Yep.
But yeah.
He's still going strong.
I know!
He's doing well for himself.
He's 95, and he was just in the Mary Poppins movie like 2 years ago.
Yeah,
dancing on a table. So I just wanted to show those. Thought that was neat that I have both their autographs. And yeah, so we hope you've enjoyed this episode, learned some new things about the Dick Van Dyke Show. And if you haven't seen it yourself, I really recommend it. It's a really great quality show, really funny.
Yes.
But now it is time for the news.
It was a dark and spooky night, and not a creature was stirring in the house. All except for me, of course, because I couldn't sleep. You know why I couldn't sleep? Well, maybe it had something to do with the snoring coming from the next room from a certain someone who was sleeping over due to home improvements being done at the house. Did they wake up when I knocked on the door? Did they move when I smacked them with a pillow? And did they even flinch when I got out a bear horn I have no idea why I own? No. They did not. Huh? Oh. And I think today in the news, a fly landed on the Queen's hat, and now Britain is exploding.
I'll tell you what. There is just no better feeling than waking up fully rested and restored. Speaking of restoring, I can now proudly say that I am an expert on all work done in restoring old homes and apartments. That's kind of where I am most specialized, I suppose. I just have so much knowledge. It just kind of spills out. I can't help but share all this wisdom with all of you. And you know, it's just the best feeling to own a home or rent an apartment and know that you can fix every single thing in there to perfection. I mean,
hey,
it's so great. What?
Your contractor's on the phone.
What?
He wants to know why you installed the faucet backwards and if he wants him to fix it so it stops leaking out the window.
What? Hello? What do you mean I installed it backwards? How's that even possible? It's a faucet. How do you put it in backwards? What? No, I did not install it in the dark. What? Okay, fine then. Can you stop it from flooding then, please? It's my new home. Okay. All right, yes, I'll pay you more. All right, bye.
It is time for the Taylor Treasure Box. Boom. You did it wrong. It's gone the full way.
No one wanted to hear the whole thing.
It wasn't much longer. Anyways.
Yeah, it was. Okay. It was going to be a while. So I ended that for you. You should thank me.
Okay.
Would you rather be a statue or a I was going to say bulldog. A statue or a building.
Okay.
Neither?
I'd go with the building. Because then you're warm.
You'd have people walking inside of you. That'd be terrible.
No, but then you're outside in the cold.
A building is also outside in the cold.
No, but you're not in
the building. You are the building.
No, stop.
It's like a human body. Okay, our insides are warm, but that's our outsides are cold.
I know, but that's what I'm saying. Like, the statue, there's nothing inside that's warming you, so you'd just be a frozen thing. But if the building, it's like your own body heat.
And what if somebody doesn't want you to be a building anymore, and they take a wrecking ball and knock you down? A statue, it's not really going anywhere unless you
take it down.
But people don't take statues down that often.
Okay, so you're going with statue?
Yes.
All right. Hey, this wasn't planned. I promise, it really wasn't. Would you rather meet Dick Van Dyke or James Roday Rodriguez? Which, if you don't know who that is, he was on another favorite show. I think it's like my two favorite is Psych and the Dick Van Dyke Show.
Sean.
Okay, stop. Why? Got people laughing here in the room.
Yep.
Okay. Dick Van. I gotta go with Dick Van Dyke.
We just did a whole show about it.
No, I would go with Dick Van Dyke because he's kind of like a legend.
He's a living legend.
He is a legend.
He's the man.
He is. But anyways, again, we hope you enjoy this episode. Comment down below, like, your favorite episode of the Dick Van Dyke Show and your favorite memories of watching them. And you can also give this video a like and a comment, and you can subscribe. And after you subscribe, make sure to press the bell to get all of our videos in your notifications box. And make sure to follow us on Instagram and Facebook, which is @TaylorTreasuresOfficial. And we'll see you next time.
Bye! Bye.